Good day to you. Welcome. This is Whistlekick Martial Arts Radio, episode 317. Today, we're going to talk a little bit about the history and the philosophy of one of the most misunderstood, misrepresented martial arts, Krav Maga. If you're new to the show, you may not know my voice. My name is Jeremy Lesniak. I'm your host for the show and the founder at Whistlekick, and I'm the guy that gets to have fun talking about martial arts a couple times a week. It's a great gig, but no, you can't have my job. What you could have is a snazzy shirt with the Whistlekick logo, or maybe a martial arts radio t-shirt. We've got a bunch of cool stuff. Check it out, whistlekick.com. You can find all of our equipment over there, our shirts, our sweatshirts, our, what else we got? I think there's some baby onesies in the store. I mean, just there's cool stuff, and we're constantly rolling out new things. So check it out. You can find the show notes, including transcripts, photos, video, a lot more for this show at whistlekickmartialartsradio.com. I don't know when I first learned about Krav Maga. It's been a while. It's probably been 20 years that I've been aware of Krav Maga. But over the last 5 to 10 years, especially because of Whistlekick, I've come to learn that a lot of people have misunderstandings of Krav Maga, of where it came from, of who participates in it, what its intended purpose is, all of that. Now, I'm certainly not going to pretend to be an expert, but we have put together this episode. It's short, but it digs into some of the history, talks about some of the original founding principles of Krav Maga. But I do want to throw a disclaimer out there. This is not the only way that Krav Maga can exist. You may train in a Krav Maga school that is different than what I'm going to express. You may do something completely different and call it Krav Maga. You may do Krav Maga and it's really not. And you know what? I don't care. I don't care because it doesn't affect me. I'm simply trying to put out some information. So if you're listening to this and you get butthurt about it, I'm sorry. You're welcome to email me. If you want to have a discussion about it, we can do that. But this is really just based on information that we've dug up from primary sources early on in the history of Krav Maga. So here we go. Krav Maga, or contact combat, is a self-defense system that uses the best techniques of different martial arts and uses them wisely depending on the scenario. The objective is to deliver a counterattack as quickly as possible and target the most vulnerable parts of the body without lowering one's defenses. The often cited main purpose of Krav Maga is to teach all types of people to respond accordingly to different forms of attacks, knowing that no two scenarios are ever exactly the same. Confrontations are avoided as much as possible, but it's not always possible. Sometimes a person will be forced to engage and defend himself or herself, or even other people. Therefore, one must train physically, mentally, and emotionally to be efficient in diverse situations. Another purpose of Krav Maga is to develop the confidence in an individual by learning the principles of self-defense and knowing how to perform basic attacks. Once a person is confident and has the necessary technical abilities, that person can walk in peace and be ready for any attack. Well, as ready as anyone can be. Krav Maga was created by Imre Lichtenfeld, aka Imi Steor, for the Israel Defense Forces, the IDF, Israel Security Agency, and Mossad, Israel's National Intelligence Agency. The self-defense system was then adopted and taught by different organizations around the world. Lichtenfeld was born in 1910 in Hungary, but he grew up in Slovakia. He was a renowned athlete during his time, having won the Youth Wrestling Championship in 1928, the Adult Division in 1929, a National Boxing Championship, and an International Gymnastics Championship. Lichtenfeld was also an excellent swimmer, but he focused on wrestling, not only as a contestant, but as a trainer. Times changed in the 1930s in Bratislava, the capital of Slovakia, when anti-Semitic groups began to riot and cause trouble for the Jewish people. As the number of troublemakers grew, Lichtenfeld decided to lead a group of Jewish boxers and wrestlers to defend their neighborhood. This was the first experience for Lichtenfeld in real-world combat, and he suddenly realized that it was very, very different from fighting inside a ring. This led to the development of his own self-defense system, where he incorporated the techniques of different martial arts and systems that proved to be useful in dangerous real-life situations. In 1940, Lichtenfeld left Europe with his family, and they took the last refugee ship bound for Palestine. Lichtenfeld's desire to protect his fellow Jews never changed, so he joined the paramilitary organization called Haganah, with a stated purpose to protect the Jews from the Arab forces. He provided training for the fighters in skills that he was knowledgeable in, such as wrestling, swimming, physical fitness, and attacking with and defending from knives. His training was recognized by many, and he trained the elite forces under Haganah. Lichtenfeld became the chief instructor for physical fitness and Krav Maga at the IDF School of Combat Fitness in 1948. During his stay at the IDF for 20 years, he was able to develop and refine his techniques of self-defense. For example, it wasn't until 1965 that judo techniques were introduced to Krav Maga, at least officially. In 1974, at age 63, Lichtenfeld retired and turned over the Krav Maga Training Center to his best student, Eli Avexar. Avexar was the first student of Lichtenfeld to be given the black belt in Krav Maga in 1971. Before this, Avexar was already a black belt in judo. He had trained in Aikido in 1968, got his brown belt in 71 in France, and this led to the introduction of Aikido techniques to Krav Maga with Lichtenfeld's assistance. In 77, Avexar went to Germany and finally received his black belt in Aikido from the European Federation. Avexar successfully proliferated the knowledge of Krav Maga in IDF as the head of Krav Maga. He required every physical education instructor to learn Krav Maga and teach it, and even increased the number of courses to be taught. In 1978, Lichtenfeld, together with six other people, established the very first Krav Maga Association, now known as Israeli Krav Maga Association, IKMA. It's a nonprofit and non-political organization that aims to become the ultimate authority in Krav Maga. Avexar retired in 1987 at the age of 40 and had trained over 80,000 male soldiers and 12,000 female soldiers. In 1989, he was still an active member of the Judo Association, and he was one of the key people who established the professional and rank committees. Avexar was replaced by Boaz Avaram, who was the last instructor to have studied with both Lichtenfeld and Avexar. Like other martial arts and systems, Krav Maga follows a set of principles that govern its discipline. It strongly discourages being involved in a fight, but if unavoidable, Krav Maga's principles and techniques are effective in most real-life situations. Some of those principles include being mindful of the surroundings. When engaged in a fight, victory should not be assumed even if the opponent seems to have many disadvantages. It is important to find escape routes and objects nearby that can be used advantageously. If outnumbered, escaping is the best option. Having presence of mind. One of the most difficult things to do is to remain calm while being attacked. Since Krav Maga teaches the basic techniques of self-defense, mastering these will help the practitioner to respond accordingly and not panic when attacked. Counterattacking immediately. If the opponent attacked first, a counterattack should be devised immediately. Attacking and defending simultaneously. Unlike other martial arts, Krav Maga does not offer the opponent the time to recover. Attack and defense are performed at the same time to deliver an attack as soon as possible. Neutralizing threat immediately. Though Krav Maga teaches fatal techniques, it does not teach to eliminate the opponent, but to preserve life as much as possible. However, as there are no ground rules in life and death situations, a self-defense technique may end up killing the opponent or permanently incapacitating them. Making techniques as simple as possible. Unlike other martial arts, Krav Maga does not teach kata or forms. The techniques of Krav Maga aim to immobilize the opponent quickly, mostly by striking, holding, and grappling, but without complexity. Being aggressive physically. Aggression will help to overcome fear and to deliver attacks as quickly as possible. Attacking continuously. The opponent should not be given the time to think and to recover when attacked. Attacks should be delivered continuously until they are immobilized or incapacitated. Striking vulnerable points. To defeat the opponent quickly, attacks should be pointed to the most vulnerable parts of the body, such as the eyes, throat, knees, solar plexus, temples, fingers, etc. Finally, retzev, or continuous motion. Retzev is a Hebrew term that literally translates to continuous motion, where the defender should constantly move while attacking and defending, and its most important purpose is to inhibit the opponent from planning further attacks, thus affecting his or her mental capacity to decide properly on what to do. Krav Maga is not a textbook-based system that has predefined forms and techniques. Rather, it is very dynamic and is continuously evolving to adapt for current real-life situations. If a new type of weapon is invented, for example, Krav Maga practitioners will find a way to develop techniques on how to defend against that weapon. Therefore, there is no universal curriculum of Krav Maga that is being followed by practitioners around the world. Still, the techniques taught in different locations are very similar to each other. The techniques in Krav Maga can be divided into two groups, derived techniques. Krav Maga is a diverse system that takes the most effective self-defense techniques from other martial arts styles. Some of them include from boxing, the hook punch, from Muay Thai, elbows, from karate, punches, from judo, aikido, and wrestling, throws, and takedowns. And then you have original techniques. Now, examples of original techniques include certain defenses against a rifle or a bat or a carjacking. This is not to say that other martial arts schools and systems don't have techniques for these, but within Krav Maga, they are presented, let's say, differently. The grading system in many Krav Maga schools is similar to that of judo. Most of the organizations around the world, though not all, now use belts to distinguish the ranks. Other organizations, such as Krav Maga Global, KMG, uses patches instead of belts. The patch system was developed by Eyal Yanilov. Yanilov was one of the best students of Lichtenfeld and one of the key people in propagating Krav Maga around the world. The grading system is separated into three main levels: practitioner, graduate, and expert. Each main level is divided into five sublevels. To move up one rank, the student must learn the corresponding curriculum and pass an exam. Each sublevel can span up to 6 months, and that is with regular training. The practitioner level is mainly for civilians who want to learn the basic self-defense against common assaults. The graduate level is for those who want to teach Krav Maga and become an official instructor. Moreover, the students in this level must have consistent proficiency in the techniques taught in the practitioner level. Now, the expert level is for instructors who want to learn how to deal with the most complex situations. Students in the expert level must display proficiency in all Krav Maga techniques. Usually, the expert level is taken by those who serve in the police, the military, you know, professions like that. Places where you might get stabbed. Sparring, that contentious form of practice, differs greatly from one Krav Maga organization to another. For example, in Krav Maga Global, there are five different levels of intensity of sparring: slow, light, medium, hard, and full contact. Each of these levels has different pace, impact, goal, mindset, rank, and even equipment. For example, with regards to equipment, slow sparring only requires mouth guard and groin protection, while in full contact sparring, it requires full protective gear and an impact-reducing suit. Most of you probably know what I mean when I say that suit. Krav Maga is a self-defense system with the original intention of teaching the army as well as civilians to fight and defend in real life. It is not generally considered a sport. As Lichtenfeld realized when he first fought in the real world, fighting inside the ring is different because it has rules and regulations that ensure the relative safety of the participants. But on the other hand, fighting in real life often deals with life and death situations. In other words, Krav Maga teaches to protect oneself with the last resort of eliminating the opponent. Now, despite this, the IDF hosted its first Krav Maga competition in 2013, and has become an annual event since. It was started to create a buzz about Krav Maga and to embed into the army as a way of life for a fighter. That's a quote. Be that as it may, the competitions were safe and regulated. The dangerous techniques, like eye strikes, were prohibited, and contestants had to wear full protective gear. So there you go. There's a bit about Krav Maga. If you're not a Krav Maga practitioner, you probably pick something up in there. If you are, well, hopefully, we still taught you something. Now, when I think back on what we just talked about, it's those principles that I find most interesting. Some of these things are not principles that I've heard discussed in most martial arts, most traditional martial arts. And yes, I consider Krav Maga a traditional martial art because of its age. If you've ever done any work with Krav Maga folks, for me, it's that continuous attack principle that resonates the most. The idea that you do not stop hitting the person until you know that you are safe. I like that. And it's something that I've brought into the way I approach self-defense. So tell me what you think. Go ahead, leave us a comment on the blog, the website, whatever you want to call it, whistlekickmartialartsradio.com. This is episode 317. You can go ahead, you can talk to us on social media. We are at Whistlekick. Find us on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, Pinterest, Tumblr. What else is out there? Google Plus. I think I just found out some things still show up on Google Plus for us. I haven't done that intentionally. Or if you really want to, you can email me, Jeremy@whistlekick.com. That's all I got. I hope you have a wonderful day, and until next time, train hard, smile, and have a great day.